quantum technologies are all about using principles from the subatomic world to process, store, and share information in new ways. But what are these principles, and what does the subatomic world have to do with processing information? Well, it's not so surprising, actually. All the material around us is composed of atoms and subatomic particles. If you want to harness those materials to do something useful, then you need to understand something about how those particles behave. That involves the study of physics, and at the subatomic level, that's called quantum physics. Now, it turns out that quantum physics appears very different from physics at the macroscopic level that you and I are most familiar with. The rules that govern the quantum world are different, and the mathematics we use to describe that world is different too. Why? It's just how nature behaves at small scales. This behavior isn't something we typically encounter in our day-to-day lives, so it might feel a little strange. But the reality is that the universe around us is built up from small particles that follow quantum rules. We live in a quantum world. Now, using our understanding of quantum physics to invent useful devices is not new. But what is relatively new is using those laws to process, store, and share information itself. That's where technologies like quantum computers come into play. We're also entering a new era where scientists and engineers are able to leverage quantum laws to build other technologies, like extremely sensitive sensors that allow us to learn more about the world around us. So let's look more closely at a concept that ties both of those opportunities together, qubits. The traditional way to encode information is to use bits, zeros and ones, which are just a convenient way of representing yes or no. And we use bits every day when sending emails, browsing the internet, or using our phone or computer. In each case, complex algorithms are at work, which use bits as their basic building blocks. And those abstract bits have physical counterparts. For example, a wire with no current flowing through it, that's a zero or a no, versus a wire where current is flowing, that's a one or a yes. A wire is just one way to physically encode a bit, and a quantum particle is another way. For instance, an electron has a property called spin. The name doesn't matter, but just know that it's analogous to the two scenarios for the wire. With an electron, one of two things can happen. Either it's spin up, analogous to zero, or it's spin down, analogous to one. Except that isn't quite true. Remember earlier that I said quantum physics appears very different from physics at the macroscopic level? This is one place where we start to see that difference. Quantum particles can represent a zero or a one, or some combination of both of those values. That's called superposition, by the way. So instead of calling them bits, we call them qubits or quantum bits. But why do they do that, and how is it possible? Well, this is just how nature operates at the quantum level. A real-world example of using an electron as a qubit is a particular defect inside a diamond called a nitrogen vacancy center, or NV center. An NV center has an electron associated with it, and when it's hit with a green laser, the NV center emits different intensities of red light depending on the spin of its electron. The details are complicated, but the rough idea is that if the electron is spin up, then we'll see a bright red light. If the electron is spin down, then we'll see a not so bright red light. And how is this useful? Because whether the electron is spin up or spin down totally depends on the magnetic field around it. In fact, changes in the magnetic field cause the electron state to alternate between spin up and spin down, which in turn changes the brightness of the red light we see. Or to think about it another way, the red light clues us into what's going on with the invisible magnetic field, and the qubit is what makes that possible. Believe it or not, these small defects in diamonds are one of the most sensitive magnetic field sensors known today. There's huge potential for this kind of technology to be used in medicine, and navigation, and to investigate properties of materials at tiny nanometer scales. Qubits also play a major role in quantum computing, where they're used to process, store, and share information in new ways. This, in turn, requires new algorithms to describe those processes and new hardware to implement those algorithms. That new kind of hardware is called a quantum computer. And because the new ways of processing information are different and sometimes better than the way we traditionally do things, some of our current algorithms will be obsolete one day. That might not sound like a big deal, but if your computer algorithm is used to secure personal data or to send private messages, then, well, it is a big deal. That's one of the main reasons why there's so much interest in quantum computing today. And it's just one of a number of quantum technologies generating lots of attention right now. And amazingly, both current technologies and those of the future are all made possible because of the laws of nature that operate at the subatomic level, which, whether we realize it or not, are at the very heart of the physical world all around us.